I was a young 18-year-old, fresh out of my freshman year at the engineering school at the University of Virginia. For the first time, I had my first professional internship, an engineering intern with Seattle Metro to handle all the transportation and water systems of Seattle, Washington. And I walked into this man's office, but it wasn't to the sedimentation tanks or the centrifuges, the bar screens. That's not where we were headed that day. We were headed to a Washington State Senator's office to discuss Social Security discrimination. And that just gives you some perspective on what this man tries to instill in us as young black engineers. Not only to develop us financially and professionally, but spiritually and culturally. And he really gives that to us this morning. He's a husband to his beautiful wife, Jamie, a father to his young child, Joshua. But more than that, he's a father to many of us young black engineers who have that passion inside us, that burning flame to serve our community. And that's why I love this man, because he's the one that flames that in us. And I could go on and talk all day about Carl Mack, because I love him so much. But we've actually prepared a video for you this morning so that you can get some perspective on this man's passion for our community.
A new generation of leadership is emerging in Seattle's African American community, thrust into the spotlight by the latest killing of a black man by a white police officer. On the front lines, leading a protest that stopped traffic, literally. Essex Porter has our story.
Looks like they're going on to the freeway, folks.
A matter-of-fact announcement marking a galvanizing moment for African-American leadership in Seattle.
It was just after the funeral. 5:20 p.m., the mourners head onto I-5, deviating from the planned route given to police. The city is caught off guard.
They did not tell us at any point in time that they had any intention of going on the freeway.
The protesters formed a circle. 10 minutes later, traffic was already backed up for more than 2 miles.
The NAACP's Carl Mack has been active for years, but now he's been urged forward as the group's lead spokesman on the Thomas matter. The next generation of local black leaders setting the pace, taking a higher profile, protesting the death of Robert Thomas Sr. at the hands of a white sheriff's deputy, the latest in what they believe is a long list of unjustified killings of black men by white law officers.
They have been killing black men in this community for far too long. We are saying right now that we are not going to tolerate not one more drop of innocent black blood.
As today's group headed towards busy Royal Bromway, again off the scheduled route, officers blocked their path on bike and in patrol cars. The group paused but didn't push forward, saying they would be lawful for now.
We march around King County Courthouse every day lawfully. We sat through the inquest process lawfully. We've come within this march lawfully. But if they care not to follow the law, then I'll be goddamn if we follow the law. For me, I need to send a message in the loudest voice possible.
But NAACP Vice President Carl Mack led a much more vocal protest.
If it means getting arrested, then start with me and start right now.
Mack leading a march protesting King County Prosecutor Norm Mailing's decision not to charge Deputy Mel Miller. He didn't get far. House.
The protesters waited outside the King County Jail until Mack was released. He got a hero's welcome.
I don't care what the price is, but there's not going to be another black man that's going to die in this county, and I'm going to sit still and let it happen.
Test march in downtown Seattle. That was back in October. Now, yesterday, Carl Mack greeted supporters with hugs and handshakes after being acquitted of pedestrian interference. Home video played during the trial showed that he did not obstruct traffic, despite police testimony to the contrary.
I'll put it to you this way. Without that videotape, those officers, lying through their teeth, would have convicted me.
Paid leave tonight for using the N-word in the classroom. But the NAACP says that's not enough. They want this teacher fired. Q13's Angela King reports.
I regret using that particular choice of words. I feel like I was making a valid point.
But instead, some say Brian Emanuel sparked a firestorm of controversy because of what he said in his classroom at Cleveland High.
I was shocked.
On May 2nd, an African-American student described an assignment as gay. Emanuels called him into the hallway and asked him how would he like to be called the N-word.
I think we need to be consistent and say all, you know, any discriminatory language in the classroom or workplace is not allowed.
Emanuels says when they walked back into the classroom, he said to the student in front of the entire class, well, I guess the N can come back in. Then asked the students,
is that okay? Absolutely not.
And the NAACP says neither is using the N-word to make a point.
We would like for Mr. Manuel to be fired.
Eric Dawson's son was in the class and heard the slur.
He could have said the N-word like we're saying it now.
He says he took the student into the hallway and explained that saying gay was like saying the N-word. When they re-entered the classroom, Emanuels told the class, well, I guess the N can come back in.
They obviously did not feel that use of the term gay in a derogatory way was a problem. So I felt like I needed to make an analogy with something that they could relate to.
There is nothing he can say to me, nothing he can say to our community. And I'd be dang if there's going to be anything he's going to ever say to our children in Seattle public schools without a fight from the NAACP.
Bring down Ghettoopoly, a board game many call a racist version of Monopoly. Tonight, the furor that started in Seattle has spread around the globe. Cairo 7 Eyewitness News reporter Kevin McCarty is live in downtown Seattle now with the new details. Kevin?
Steve, we've learned tonight that the makers of Monopoly are threatening to sue the creator of Ghettoopoly for copyright infringement, but the problems don't stop there. The Seattle chapter of the NAACP is planning demonstrations right here in the heart of Seattle's downtown shopping district. The demonstrators say they want to make their feelings known about a game that has them outraged. It all started when the national chain of upscale boutiques started carrying Ghettoopoly, the Monopoly knockoff that uses negative images of African Americans. A black man holding a machine gun and malt liquor are featured as the logo. Game pieces include machine guns, crack cocaine, a basketball, and a marijuana leaf.
And NAACP, we will have no problem fighting for the racial dignity of our people. If that means that we need to be out here and disrupt their business, they can damn well bet that that's what's going to happen.
Mac is demanding that the store stop selling that game.
An international furor over the game arose when Carl Mack and the Seattle NAACP marched into Urban Outfitters demanding the game be removed from the shelves. Police removed Mack from the store, but the game also disappeared, and the outrage over Ghettoopoly spread nationwide.
First of all, I'm excited that there's that many people in this world who believe that this type of insensitivity does not belong in today's society.
But Mack says it will take a lot more than pulling Ghettoopoly off the shelves to get Urban Outfitters off the hook.
That until you come to us as the president, as the owners of Urban Outfitters, and tell us that you're sorry, to apologize to us, to show some type of sensitivity for the harm that you've caused this community, we will make sure that Santa Claus puts a lump of coal in their stockings.
And that lump of coal disrupt the crucial Christmas shopping season for Urban Outfitters. The NAACP has demonstrations planned for 10 o'clock tomorrow morning right down here in the Westlake District, right there by Urban Outfitters. I tried to contact the maker of Ghettoopoly in Pennsylvania, David Chang. He's not answering his phone tonight.
Today, a manager at the downtown store tells us that has now changed.
The company has pulled the game completely. We're not going to sell it at all due to customer concern.
So it's not available?
It's not available.
But Carl Mack of the NAACP isn't buying it.
That's urban legend. We ain't got no written report. Everybody's got rumors going on. Those are urban legends from Urban Outfitters.
Mack and the others say they won't leave without a written commitment never to sell the game again.
And an apology from the retailer's CEO.
Until we get that letter from them with an apology, Urban Outfitters!
Welcoming a mechanical engineer at Seattle Metro and the president of the Seattle NAACP chapter, Carl Mack.
Wow. Justin Steele, come here for a second. Eric, if you could join me. Nesbitt, first of all, there's a lot of things that I expected when I stood before you, but the response to watching a brother try to fight for the social and racial dignity of our people and to see you all respond in such a positive way, I really wasn't really prepared for that. So if I get a little emotional, that's okay, but just forgive a brother for that. Good. 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 And I'm fortunate, and the reason I wanted to introduce this beautiful young brother to you, this is Derrick Jones. And for those of you from Florida, you may have heard of his father. His father is Darrell Jones, former senator. And his father was one of the first men to introduce reparations for us as a people with the Rosewood legislation. But more importantly to that, his father was the first positive, beautiful black man I ever saw in my life, and I literally fell in love with this man. And he never knew how much he impacted my life, so to have his son here is an honor. So I want you to show some Nesbitt love to Derrick Jones. And I've had the pleasure of having a group of engineers, of young black students that I've tried to provide a holistic education. And when I say a holistic education, I think that there are four components to a holistic education. There's a spiritual component that makes you believe in something that's bigger than you. There's a cultural component, because how can you go through and get a formal education and be called a degreed engineer, a formally educated person, and you don't know who you are as a black person? That's insane. So you need to know who you are. Third, there's the training that every one of these schools, colleges, and universities will give you. And then fourth, you need to understand money, because if you don't, you're going to be a working slave. I don't care what your degree is. And of all the students that I've had, and that's no disrespect to any of you that may be sitting in the audience, Justin Steele represents the greatest intern I have ever had. Thus, I call him the intern, Justin Steele. I love you. Thank you. You know, I've heard the term Nesbitt love quite a bit. I embody Nesbitt love. I am Nesbitt love. You're looking at me and you're thinking, he's just messing around. But there were some sisters who was riding on the van when I came in, and I was telling them about my wife, and I'm going to prove to you all that I am quintessential Nesbitt love, me and my family. There was a conference that we had in Charlotte, North Carolina, a couple, three, 4 years ago. The whole time I was at that conference, all I had on was shorts, a baseball hat, and shades. And that's all I wear now. And when I was there, I saw this sister. Fine little sister. She needs to start making her way up here. So when I saw her, when we got to the big banquet, the whole time all I had on was shorts, baseball hat, shades. So when I get to the banquet, I'm suited. And she sees me, she like, "Ooh, girl, is that Carl? Carla! Like, girl, put your tongue in your mouth. You ain't going nowhere." So I scroll up there, and she's sitting down, and they got her salad in front of her. And I reach out my hand, and I said, "Look, I'm looking for a place to see. You know, can you help a brother out?" And I'm thinking she's just going to sit there and eat, but no, she reaches out and grabs my hand. So we start walking, and we kind of locked up, and I'm kind of feeling it. Visceral. I'm a visceral kind of brother. So anyway, afterwards, I said, "Well, look, why don't we meet up after, you know, at the dance afterwards?" And so we meet up, and I got my coworker, and she's got one of her girlfriends, and I tell them, "Look, y'all need to lose this scene." So when they get lost, her and I are talking. You better remember my last name. So we lose them, and as I'm talking to her, I'm vibing this sister. So I ask her one question, and everything depends on the answer to this question. Whether I see her again, or I never see her again, or I never wake up without seeing her again, it depends on this question. Because in a 2-hour conversation, I asked this woman to marry me. And everybody said to me, well, why would you do it in 2 hours? Because in 2 hours, she did what I needed her to do, make me feel like she was the best that could ever happen to me. And this was the question. I said, if we're going across the Old West in a covered wagon, and we're thousands of miles away from civilization, you're inside because I built you a log cabin. I was a little chauvinist. But I built the log cabin, and you inside taking care of the house. And I'm outside plowing the field because we have to get this crop planted in order to survive the winter. And you look out that window, and you see me standing in the hot sun over my dead mule because he just dropped dead. What's the first thing you say to me? Now, some of y'all have told me, well, baby, I don't know what I say to you. I accepted that answer, but it wasn't my answer. Some of y'all have said to me, now here we are in the middle of nowhere, now what we gonna do out here? I respected that answer, understood that answer, but it wasn't an answer for me. This woman looked at me and she said, I would say to you, baby, I'm not strong enough to pull that plow, so you pull it and I'll drive it. I looked at her and I kissed her in front of a room full of folks and I said, I want to marry you. She said, let's do this. 2 weeks later, it's done. I want y'all to meet my wife, Jeremy, and our son, Joshua. But now let me tell you this. I thought I was laying it down, right? But the part of the story I didn't tell you was Jamio's last name was Mac. So who got played? My wife, Jamio. And my little man, Joshua, he's asleep. Okay. Michelle. Madam President, Madam Director, thank you so much for your hospitality and being here. To my brother Woody from Dale, thank you so much for your sponsorship. But let me go ahead and put my disclaimer here, because people sometimes get nervous when I speak, and you can tell because of what I do in Seattle. But I have to roll like that, people. I can't take what these cats out there doing. So anything I say, look, it's about me. I'm here to talk to you, not at you. I don't mean to offend Dell, Microsoft, Warehouse, or nobody else. But I need to get to you. I need to get to you. Our theme is strengthening the pipeline to success. Give me that mission statement, Nesbitt. Now you can tell by looking at that mission statement up there that I got a couple of words emphasized culturally to provide you cultural responsibility. When I graduated from Mississippi State with a mechanical engineering degree, no sense of culture. Last name Mac, I'm thinking I'm a good looking brother. The only thing I can think about is getting my groove on with as many of you fine little sisters as I can get my hands on. That was my mindset, very selfish. And it's okay to admit that selfishness now, because I've grown. Culture has helped me to grow. This brother, Dr. Edward Jones, professor from the University of Washington, I apologize if his picture's not there. But Dr. Jones has to be one of the most beautiful brothers that I've ever met in my life, one of the most influential brothers, because he's the one that gave me that culture responsibility. Now, I want to look at your theme, and I know that in the paper they had a different theme that I was supposed to speak to, but I'm going to speak to the theme of the conference, strengthening the pipeline to success. And I want to use your mission statement to show you exactly where we are. Now, one has to define, what is the pipeline? What is it? See, people want to talk about the pipeline like it's some inanimate object, like the government. Well, the government is us, the people. Well, what is the pipeline? I say the pipeline consists of three major entities. One is the founders, Brother Tony Harris, Brother Brian Harris, Ed Coleman, George Smith, John Logan, and Brother Stan Kirkley, all of the guidance of Dr. Arthur Bond. And so at this point, I've had an opportunity to go to a lot of your websites. Rarely, if ever, did I find what these brothers look like. I read about them, but I never saw them. So for those of you who have your websites up, go back and do true honor to these brothers. Put it up for ignorant individuals like myself who may not know what they look like. and put it up there so people can see who this Chicago Six was. Now my heart is heavy this morning because we've lost yet another one of our brothers, Brother Stan Kirkley. So I would like for all of us here at Nesbitt to stand in a moment of silence at the loss of one of the founders, one of the Chicago Six. Thank you. We're having some issues because a lot of my photos aren't coming up, but that's okay. Life gives you lemonade, lemonade. When I thought about the founders and what they created 30 years ago, could anybody have seen what we see now? I would beg to differ, but there was a brother by the name of Dr. Carter G. Wilson, and most of us know Dr. Wilson because he is the founder of what we now celebrate as Black History Month. Dr. Carter G. Wilson, in a very profound book, and I would encourage you to all read it, Dr. Carter G. Wilson said this. He said, real education means to inspire people to live more abundantly, to begin with life as they find it, then to make it better. But the instructions thus far given most Negroes in colleges and universities has worked to the contrary. In many cases, it simply increases the number of malcontents who offer no solution to the problems about which they complain. Now, in layman's terms, what Dr. Woodson said is that most of us will complain about what is wrong, but very few of us will get up and do something about it. This Chicago Six saw something 30 years ago that was wrong. They saw no black engineers out there, not to the numbers that they wanted. And the six of them got together and formed a group called the National Society of Black Engineers. And look at us 30 years later. How do you not love that? How do you not respond in a positive way to that? But more important, it was the vision that they had. Look at that mission statement. They said what? To increase the number of what? They didn't say spiritually responsible. No disrespect to us spiritually. They didn't say to produce increase financially responsible. They said culturally responsible. Because see what is going to happen to many of you. You're going to get out there and you're going to get inside these corporations and you're going to forget where you came from. You're going to all of a sudden start adapting against inside of a mold that don't look nothing like you, don't think like you. And when you see somebody that looks like you, you're going to turn your back to them. Shame on you. Oh, don't look at me and say, oh, no, not me. Oh, it's happening. As a matter of fact, when you saw me shut that freeway down, you know who killed that black man? It was a King County law enforcement officer. I work for King County. Everybody in the NAACP saying, Carl, you can't bite the hand that feeds you. I say, how in the world do you expect me as the NAACP to go out there and tell any other corporation that they're doing wrong if I can't clean up my own entity? Bite my hand, that's why I married the black woman I did. Because when she married me, she said, baby, I understand what you're all about. And if that means we lose our job to stand up for who we are as black people, then let's lose it. We'll find another. We'll find another. I'll wear your handcuffs, but I will never wear corporate America's platinum handcuffs. I will never wear them. Not that I ain't got respect, but many times those platinum handcuffs come with a price. They want me to forget who I am. They might say we love diversity. I'll put you to the test on that. I have, just like at Metro King County, the whole internship program is black. That's what they call it now. They're the black co-op program. Hey, look, I got to get mine. And I ain't got no shame in my game about doing it. But back to this pipeline. The pipeline is our past. The pipeline is the present. It's you, the collegiate members, and you, the alumni. I still consider you the present. And then the pipeline is made up of PCI. Like my son Joshua, he's a part of that, and I'm very proud of what Nesbitt has been doing to reach out to the PCI. But now let's look at the other part of that theme, strengthening the pipeline. Is our pipeline stronger than it's ever been before? Ever? in the history of this organization. Is our pipeline stronger? And if it's not, and if it's in need of repair or replacement, which of those would we choose? To replace NASBY is asinine. So if indeed this pipeline is in need of repair, of strengthening, I'm sorry, let's repair it. We're not going to replace it. Now I want to show you how I came about my culture. This is a picture of the first Black History calendar that I ever put together. And then that's the second edition because people didn't want to tear the pages off the first edition. So I designed a second one. And then because of Daryl Jones, whose son you just met, Derek, and my wife, I did a third edition. That's Black Heritage Day 3. And what this is a desktop calendar that sits on your desk every day. And every day now, I do what I never did for the first 30-some-odd years of my life, and I'm 41 now. I wake up every day and take a few minutes and read about who I am as a Black man, and I love it. So that's what Black Heritage Day 3 represents. One of the first people that I ever heard about out of Black history was Henry O. Flipper. My brother's from West Point, much love. And see, those brothers know how difficult it is to go through the West Point Military Academy. And at the time that Henry O. Flipper graduated in 1877, keep in mind, people, that we were in slavery up until 1865 with the passage of the 13th Amendment. This brother graduated from West Point, and when he graduated, nobody ever spoke to him the whole time he was there. Excuse me, can you tell me where? Excuse me. Yes, sir. Because if you dared to speak to him, they would in turn give you the silence treatment too. But even enduring all of that and the rigors of West Point, he still graduated. If I would have been going to Mississippi State and knew about him then, nothing about Mississippi State would have deterred me. Nothing about Mississippi State would have gave me an inferiority complex. But I didn't know who I was as a Black man. I didn't know. But when I learned about O. Flipper, I came to love and respect that brother. And it was a white man that told me about it. Let me tell you something about history. You can talk about technology till you blue in the face. But in the words of Malcolm X, of all of our studies, history is best qualified to reward our research. When you find that you have a problem, all you have to do is study the historical methods of people with problems like yours. When you find out how they solve theirs, you'll know how to solve yours. Dr. Jones told me, he who controls history controls the world. He who defines rules. These might be cliches to you, but they're ways that I live my life. We must never let nobody else define who we are as a Black people. Because if they do, they will write you right out of history. They will disrespect you in every turn. Now, to prove this point to you, up here are four textbooks. One copyrighted in 1994, one in 1990, one in 1950, one in 1863. I'm going to take a commonly known fact out of American history, because there truly is no such thing as Black history. History is history, it's just a matter of whose perspective are you going to tell history from. And this country has always told history from a Eurocentric perspective, with a little sprinkling of slavery, with a little sprinkling of Harriet Tubman. I can tell you this when they talk about diversity. Let me tell you what I see when I see diversity. There's the table of diversity. Let's go over and peep in there and just see what's happening in the room. Here come the Europeans with thousands of years of culture and diversity sitting at the table. Here come the Native Americans with thousands of years, had their land stolen, but they still got their culture and their history. Here come the Pacific Islanders and the Asian brothers and sisters, thousands of years of culture sitting at the table of diversity. Here come our brothers from down south, I'm talking south of the border, coming up to the table of diversity, sitting down there, ready to organize. But now here comes the African American, got his cool little stroll on, sitting at the table of diversity. Don't know jack nothing about who he is as a Black man, but he's at the table of diversity to argue everybody else's perspective. That's what I see about diversity. And when I start loving who I am, I'm accused of being anti-white. I ain't anti-nothing, I'm just in love Black. That's all. But the point is this, you don't let nobody else define you as a point. March 5th, 1770, the first person to die
in defense of this country was who?
Chris Nesbitt.
Say it loud, Nesbitt.
Chris
Nesbitt. Damn it, I'm having trouble hearing this morning. Talk to me. Let's be in love. Many of you have seen my son running around with nobody there. And y'all look at him. When you see him, then you look around and you see me. You know him as daddy. Then you look at me strange. Why are you looking at me strange? He's among 5,000, 10,000 of his own brothers and sisters. Is he in trouble? Somebody gonna hurt him? Well, welcome and let him explore the world. Who gonna come in here and mess with him? With all his brothers and sisters. Okay, so let's be in love, Nesbitt. The first conference I went to was in Pittsburgh. Everybody was in love. I come here now, y'all walking. I feel like I'm up in Seattle somewhere. Love, that's love. Now let's be in love. Everybody loosen your eyes up and let's love. All right. Now this book is covered. Okay. Back this up. Back it up again. All right, here we go. That brother back there is listening. I love that. Now, a commonly known fact. March 5th, 1770. The first person to die in defense of this country was who? What color man? And he was what number to die? That was the first. 1863, the book is clear. Now look at the book in 1950. The book in 1950. Technology, you see what I'm saying? See, history don't fail you like this. It's technology. One more, girl. There you go. Okay, you know what? I can tell you what it says without that. In 1950, the book says this. The first civilian killed was Crispus Attucks, a black man. That's what the book says in... I'm about to just absolutely just... Okay, the book in 1950 says the first person to die was Crispus Attucks. Move past that. That's all right, go to the next one. 1990. Okay, now look. Okay, fine. If they want to ruin my build-up, fine. But look what the book in 1994 says. Read it to me. I thought he was number one in 18... See, March 5th, 1770, he was number one. 1863, he was number one. 1950, he was number one. But 1990, he was among those who died. 1995, five men, including Attucks. See, they done took the privilege of this black man being the first to die in defense of this country and now moved him amongst five men. 25 years from now, you won't even see his name. It'll be like you, or better yet, it'll be like your children's children trying to convince their children that Michael Jackson was a black man. It'll be hard. They will write you right out of history. Let me give you another example. This is a picture of Alexander Dumas. Dumas wrote The Three Musketeers. He wrote The Man in the Iron Mask and he wrote The Count of Monte Cristo. Now, when he wrote The Three Musketeers, he was talking about his black father who was a general in Napoleon's army, a man to be of such legendary strength that he could ride underneath a beam on horseback, grab that beam and lift the horse up off the ground. So when he wrote about The Three Musketeers, he was writing about his black father and his black friends. So, but when you seen The Three Musketeers, who were they talking about? Keith Sullivan and all these cats. The Three Musketeers should have been Denzel, Arsenio, and me. I'll show you. Look at this picture. Now let's read this. This is a picture of Andromeda tied to the rocks. Now let's get to the bottom. She was the daughter of Cepheus and Cassiopeia, the king and queen of Ethiopia. Look at the picture. Do the math, Nesbitt. Hurry up. You never allow somebody else to define who you are. They will always define you in a negative light. That's why we must become stewards of our culture. That's why the founders of Nesbitt talked about increasing culturally responsible engineers, black engineers. I don't care how much technology you get. I don't care how many degrees you get. You must get that culture. That is what we most need. And love.
My wife told me, she said, baby, give them a little bit about reparations since you like it so much. And there's all this discussion about reparations. Yes, I'm an engineer, but I've gone back to do what Nesbitt Founder said, to become culturally responsible. So I want to take you through reparations, the early days. And I know some of you, because you're younger, you think 40 Acres and a Mule is a Spike Lee production, but it's really got a little bit more meaning than that. Here's the history of 40 Acres and a Mule. Brief history. Started with William Sherman, who was over the Union Army, and he's on his march to the sea, and he's burning down everything in his path. Tearing down homes, burning down homes, and the black folks, we just joined right in with his 40,000 troops. We just joined right in. We knew we was gonna be protected. So when Sherman gets to Savannah, he turns and looks behind him, and all these black folks in his east side, oh, stay, go back to the plantation. We like, Sherman, you done lost your mind. We don't make no plantation. What's wrong with you? So out there, Sherman met with 20 black leaders of Savannah. He said, do you want your own land, or do you want to live amongst these people? They said, come on now, Brother Sherman, you know the answer to that. We got to get our own. So Sherman issued Special Field Order number 15. When he issued that, Edward M. Stanton, who's the Secretary of War under Lincoln, was out there. And Stanton said, Sherman, you can't do that. That's not the law. Sherman said, son, out here I am the law. So he issued Special Field Order number 15. But now I want you to pay attention to what Special Field Order number 15 said. It said from Charleston, 30 miles inland from the sea, all the way down to the St. John River in Florida, this land is to be set aside for the exclusive settlement of blacks. Each family is to receive 40 acres of tillable land and a government-issued mule. Look at that land. That's oceanfront. Special Bill number 15 went up to the Congress as Senate Bill number 60. It was introduced in the Senate by three men. Lyman Turnbull, a senator from Illinois. Thaddeus Stevens, Republican from Pennsylvania, and Charles Sumner, a senator from Massachusetts. Now, once the bill got introduced, and all three of these men are supposed to be up there, by the way, but that's okay, just follow me. Once the bill got introduced to both houses, the House and the Senate, by Turnbull, it passed the House. Then it passed the Senate. Now, once a bill passes the House and the Senate, what does it need to become law? Good. I'm just a bill and a bill. Remember? So all it needed was the president's signature to become law. But something happened on April 14, 1865. Lincoln went to Ford's Theater. When he was sitting there, John Wilkes Booth came up and shot him in the back of the head. When they killed Lincoln, this knucklehead became president. Andrew Johnson, Democrat from Tennessee. So when he became president, what did he do? He vetoed Senate Bill number 60. He gave pardons to all the ex-Confederate soldiers that led the South out of the Union, returning them back so that they could reclaim their land. He began to systematically tear apart the Freedmen's Bureau. And the Freedmen's Bureau was set up by Lincoln to do four things. It was to give land to the newly freed slaves. It was to give education to the newly freed slaves. And that's where all of your historical, many of your historical black colleges and universities came out of, was the Lincoln administration under the Freedmen's Bureau. And the person who was in charge of the Freedmen's Bureau was Oliver Otis Howard. Who's in here from Howard University? That's who he is, the president and namesake of your famed black university, Howard University. The third thing it was to do was to give political power to the black folks. That's why when you look at Reconstruction, the people that started public education in the South were your black legislators. You had black lieutenant governors, black judges, black everything. When you came and looked at the houses, filled with us. But then something happened. When they talk about history repeating itself in the presidential election of 1876 between Rutherford B. Hayes and Samuel Tilden, a little deal was struck. Hayes, who was a Republican, him and Tilden made a deal. Tilden said, I'll tell you what. Being a Democrat, I'll give you the presidency. But what you got to do is, you got to give up all those federal troops that are protecting them black folks down there. And Hayes, sell out for power. I'm gonna tell you about being a sellout for power a little bit later. Hayes says, okay, I'll agree to it. So when they did that little exchange, they pulled all the federal troops out of the South. And then Samuel Tilden, a senator from South Carolina participated in the Ellington riots, and this is what he said. It was then, it was a battle between African barbarianism and white Caucasians for the mastery of the government. It was then that we shot them. It was then that we killed them. It was then that we stuffed the ballot boxes because desperate diseases require a desperate remedy. And that's how they wiped out all these black folks that were serving in political office because of this knucklehead, returning them back to their power. I don't like you, Andrew Johnson. I don't like you at all. I don't like you. History makes you that way, though. And that's a page from my calendar, 40 Acres and a Mule, that describes all of what I just described to you. But see, I talk about reparations now. This is the part I like. Because in order for me to understand and debate it now, I need to understand what happened then. Reparations. It's a standard of practice in the international law. The United Nations negotiates, the International Court of Justice orders it. Now, here's the examples of reparations, because people want to start talking about us setting the precedent. Oh, no, we ain't setting the precedents for it. Look at it. 1952, Germany gave up $58 billion. 1976, Australia gave up 96,000 square miles. In 1980, Canada gave up $230 million. Look at what the United States did in 1988. They gave up $1 billion and they offered an apology. And then when it came to offering us an apology, what did they say? They got to debate it. Why? Because you are still America's stepchild. Don't you be fooled by diversity and inclusion. You still a stepchild. Don't you be fooled when they go out there and shoot black men and they still can't bring them to justice. Oh, you think I'm kidding you? Look at the paper I just happened to find today in Louisiana. Look at what it says. Look at what it says. Huh? Experts doubt officer will be convicted of murder. You know what? Take this off the screen and put this so that everybody can see the headlines and know I'm not making it up. Camera three, get him on camera three. There you go, straight ahead. Put that up there. You see what that says? Experts doubt. Close up. Y'all let me know when you can read it. Now, why is it that the experts doubt it? Because you still America's stepchild. Shoot him, kill him. Kill a Negro, become a hero. Oh no, them days finna change, baby. I ain't fighting no battle, so it's status quo. I'm gonna make everybody uncomfortable around this camp. But now back to reparations. African Americans. 200 plus years, millions of us have died. But why can't we get reparations? I'll tell you part of the reason why. Because we are lacking that cultural responsibility. Most of us don't know who we are as black folks. We don't know the black experience and we run from it. We fear our history. We still fear America. We fear each other. That's why we walk past each other here in Nesbitt, don't even speak. Right. Acting like you all that. You better recognize. And I want you to know something, Nesbitt. They're watching. Your brothers and sisters out there are watching. Me and my family sat down to breakfast this morning. And Mr. Badger, who was the cook at the Hyatt, he came up to me. I was getting my grits. He said, you like them grits, don't you? Yes, sir. I'm up in Seattle and I don't get them like I want them all the time. He said, well, sir, how you eat them grits? I said, well, I put butter on them, salt and pepper. Put the egg and bacon and all that, mix it all up in there. He said, well, I'm from West Texas, and I used to eat mine with sugar on it. I said, I ain't gonna blame you for that, all that stuff. But that's not the point of the conversation. What he said to me was this. He said, we don't see too many conferences like this. All you black folks coming up in here. He said, you're so fine looking and so respectful. We're proud of you. Our people are watching us. There's been a debt that's paid for us. We must always be on our best. They're watching. And I love the fact that they're watching. I love the fact that they're proud. Back to reparations. Millions have died, 200 plus years of slavery. Why? Here's my argument for reparations, because some of you have been on your campus, and what's that knucklehead, all right, coming around with 12 reasons why blacks shouldn't get reparations. Horowitz, that's him. Horowitz. Horowitz came to the University of Washington. Tyrone, where you at? Tyrone called me up and said, Brother Mac, there's this man coming here talking about why black folks shouldn't get reparations. And I sat in a convention hall in Kane Hall. All them folks in there. And they loving Horowitz. They just loving him. Go ahead, David. Tell them black folks
why they shouldn't get reparations. David said, now listen to me. Slavery ended in 1865. That's been over 150 years ago. All the people who were slaves, they're dead. All the direct descendants of those people who were slaves, they're dead. On the other side, all the slave owners, they're dead. And all their direct descendants are dead. So if you can't find somebody who was a direct beneficiary of slavery that was alive yesterday and still alive today, why should anybody today have to pay that had nothing to do with it? Oh, they went crazy. Yes, David, yes, tell them. I sat there and I said, David, that's one hell of a good argument. So then I stood up like a great black stallion. I said, Brother David, your argument was profound. I loved it. But I got a question for you, David. Why don't you explain to this audience Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution? And he looked at me like this. Excuse me. Now, normally I would let somebody off the hook, but I let him fry in that fish grease I just put him on. And you know that fish grease get hot, so I let him sit there and murmur. Just murmur. Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution was my argument for reparations, which now dealt with. Don't worry about it being gone, I got you. Article 1, Section 9 of the Constitution says this: the migration or importation of such persons as any of the states now existing shall think proper to admit shall not be prohibited by the Congress prior to the year 1808. But a tax or a duty may be imposed on such importation not exceeding $10 for each person. Now you see the way y'all looking at me? What does that really mean? In layman's terms, what it says is this: that the United States government in 1788 ratified in the Constitution, and that's what I love about the Constitution. You can never erase it, you can only what? Amend it. So in 1788, in the Constitution, arguably the most sacred document in the history of this country, America's crime is revealed to the world. Her participation in the most nefarious trade is right there for all the world to see. And Karl Marx, young Nesbitt engineer, who is culturally responsible, sees it. And I had to remind David Horowitz of it. So when I told Horowitz of that, I said, now what is that saying? Explain it to him, David. He didn't want to explain it. So they looked at me. Well, Mr. Mack, maybe you'd like to explain it. I said, what Article 1, Section 9 is saying in layman's terms is that America was sitting right there at the shore. And every time a ship rolled up full of our ancestors, America collected a tax of up to $10 for every black that came in, which says that she was directly a beneficiary of the slave trade. And I know exactly how much she owes me. Because then they start saying, well, how do you know how much she owes you? And I said, because I took it. As punitive damages against the United States. When it comes to the interest rate, I'm not going to charge you 18% on the Freedom Card Queen Latifah rate. I'm going to charge you just a mere 6%. When you look at the number of years that she's been owing me, that $7 million is 200 and... my master a little bad. It should be 216 years. But for the purposes of this argument, let's go ahead with yesteryears, what they owe us. So when you do 700,000 times 10, raise times 6%, raise to the 215 power. The math don't lie. Chemical engineer. I ain't kidding. My wife's a chemical engineer from FAMU. I'm gonna tell you something right now. My wife is the smartest person I know in the world. So when I did this formula, she said, that ain't right, Carl. What did 50% So I had to give her 50%. That's not the argument for reparations, people. That is simply a argument. When I presented that argument to Horowitz, you know what Horowitz did? He rolled up his papers and he left. Am I lying, Tyrone? He left. That's what cultural knowledge will do. As much as I wanted to go here with Horowitz, I went here. It was a higher power. I go there with Seattle all the time. Every time they see me coming, oh Lord. And I'm coming hard. All right. Let's get back to the theme now, strengthening the pipeline, because we needed to go through just a touch of that cultural thing. Strengthening the pipeline. The question is, why should we strengthen the pipeline? There's the answer, because we are in a crisis. Nesbitt, we are in a crisis. This is where the fun and games is over. This is where you and I get real personal and real serious with one another right now. This is it. Mr. Lowry, are you in the audience? Yes, there he is. See, Mr. Lowry, back to stand up. Don't sit down yet, because I need you all to believe what I'm saying to you. Mr. Lowry is from the great state of Mississippi. He's from Starkville, Mississippi. I went to school in Starkville, Mississippi. So me and Mr. Lowry didn't know each other the other night, but we sat down and had breakfast. Dinner. We didn't need to know each other. We got to know each other. We've always known each other. He's my daddy, in a sense. So I asked Mr. Lowry, okay, Mr. Lowry, I just needed them to know that we had this conversation. So I asked Mr. Lowry, as we sit on the 50th anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education, arguably the greatest piece of civil rights victory ever won in this country, and it's won by who? It's won by the NAACP. For you, most of you don't have a clue about Brown versus Board of Education. You talk about your Chicago Six, our Chicago Six. This is my NAACP 9. Brother Jenkins, Brother Nasbury, Brothers Robinson, Marshall, Tate, Reddings, Reeves, Greenberg, Hayes. These brothers fought arguably the greatest battle in civil rights. But I would argue today, when you start talking about strengthening the pipeline, this is what I want to say to you. Our pipeline is deteriorating right here and right now before our very eyes, and we don't have a clue. So I am here today to tell you to wake up and take a very serious look at that pipeline. Now, am I kidding you? You know what Mr. Lowry and I talked about? See, he went to high school and graduated in 1966 when it was segregated times, and he went through all black. It was an all black institution. They're giving me the time, so I'm gonna hurry up and get through here. Give me 7 minutes, 2 minutes. All right, really I need about, anyway, 5. All right, here we go. Let's hurry up and get through this part. Okay, listen, at least 1966 when he went to high school, Mr. Lowry told me that in his graduating class, all black, 200 or 300, 1% did not graduate. What is 1% of 300? Three didn't graduate. I graduated from Lanier High School in Jackson, Mississippi in 1980. When I graduated out of my class, two or three went back and got their high school diplomas. But today, damn near half of you ain't graduated. The other half is special ed, and the other half is on Ritalin. They are destroying my children today. So if in chance, when I graduated out of my class, 1% was not graduating, but today, 30, 40, maybe 50% is not graduating, what does that say about your pipeline, Nesbitt? What does it say? And who is responsible? You are. Don't you go and blame nobody else, because the founder said, I want to increase culturally responsible engineers, culturally responsible, who make a positive impact. When I get out there on that street and fight, I am embodied of what those founders was talking about. You can't blame nobody else. You, even right now, as you go through that pipeline, you got to go back. And Mr. Lowry told me, Carl, I rarely, if ever, see black engineers that go back. All I know is a few. I know Tyrone goes back. I know Justin goes back. I know Mr. Lowry goes back. I know my wife and I go back. But that's it. That's all I know. You ask yourself right now, how many of you are going back? When I went to high school, I didn't have half the resources you got. We didn't have no internet. I didn't have no computer. But 1% of us did not graduate. Today, damn near half of you ain't graduating. Now, as we wake up, your pipeline is weak. Oh, it might look good right now. You might think it looks good right now. But 20 years from now, it's going to keep thinning out just like it's doing now. It's going to continue to thin out. We got to go back and get our children. Now, if indeed you are the most fundamental element of the pipeline, I need to address this issue with you. Now, you heard the part up there about that teacher using the N-word. But this is me. 10 years I've been coming to this conference. You represent my best, my absolute best. I have never come to this conference and not heard that term, nigga or niggas. And you've given me every reason. Mr. Mack, white people say nigger, we say niggas, it's a difference. What is the difference? There is no difference. I hear you bumping your music, niggas, niggas. I hear you bumping your music, bitches and hoes. Your black woman best epitomizes you, black man. Who am I without Jamie Roe? I'm nobody. And the last time I looked, Jamie Roe ain't never been no bitch. She ain't never been no hoe. As a matter of fact, if you think I'm wrong about this statement, any man that does not appreciate his history, does not appreciate black women, does not know his history. Now, you might think that's just a statement, but for any of you who play chess, tell me the most powerful piece on the board. It's a queen, baby. It's a queen. But this is what we do. All up through here, I hear this term from my best and my brightest. That's you people. You all represent my best and my brightest. I can no longer have this. When I grew up in Mississippi, I used to use the word nigga like the word the. Nigga, please, that nigga crazy. Nigga. You know, oh, it ain't funny. It ain't funny at all, miss. You know why I used it? Because America indoctrinated me with the poison. They left me culturally ignorant about who I am as a black man. But now, just like Brother Malcolm came to an understanding of who he is as a black man, Carl Mack is a Renaissance man. He's been reawakened. He's a rebirth now. Look at this, and I feel their pain. That's why I want you to look at this. I want you to feel. What does it take to turn a brother's back into a grapevine like that? Well, here's the story that goes along with that. My name is William Colvin. I was from Georgia. I was born in 1845 on my master's plantation down in Fort Valley. My master was named Jim Holderson. You know, one time he had 165 of us niggas. No, son, none of us hated to be bought up by him because he's so mean. You know, I remember my brother January was on the plantation seeing a gal one time on his past and give out he's over an hour late. When he come home, the master was mad as a hive of bees. He said, now, nigga, I'm gonna teach you some sense. And with that, he started laying on the lashes. And Brother January, his body was a shaking, his mouth was a quivering, but he never said a word. I was sitting on my mammas and pappas, the steps are crying. All the niggas was gathered up out there, and after a while, they couldn't take it no longer, and they had to go inside their cabins. But after a while, Brother January, he couldn't take it no longer himself, and he said in a loud, hoarse whisper, Massa, Massa, mercy on this poor nigga. So see, where did we learn the word nigga from? We didn't learn it from white folks. We learned it from black folks. See, I learned it from my mama. I learned it from my daddy. I learned it from my girlfriend. I learned it from my boys. But I can guarantee you this, my son will never learn it from me. never learning from them. I will break it, and I'm asking you to break it. Walter White, second black executive director of the NAACP, he tells this story of a black woman named Mary Turner. Back in 1921 in Valdosta, Georgia, she was 8 months pregnant. 8 months pregnant. And this mom had killed her husband. And she cried out for justice. Being 8 months pregnant, they caught her and took her into the woods. And they tied her ankles up. And they hoisted her up a tree. And a man walked up and he poured motor oil and gasoline all over her body. And they set her afire. And they said you could smell the burn of her flesh. And then a man walked up with a butcher knife and he started from her womb and he carved upwards and just split her wide open. And her fetus fell to the ground, 8 months, and it was alive and it cried out. And this man, he stomped the life out of that fetus. And then they backed up and they unloaded 200 bullets into her body. Every time I hear one of you say nigger, those are the images that come up inside of me. Every time I hear it, it hurts me to no end. So now I'm going to be your daddy. I can forgive your ignorance because ignorance means you don't know. Today you know because I just put you on notice. And so I'm gonna treat you like you my child. And if I hear you say it, I'm gonna hear you up. And I want you to first apologize to yourself. I want you to apologize to your ancestors. And I want you to apologize to the founders who put you here, not for you to embarrass us like this. I want you to learn to love who you are. Because if indeed you are the most fundamental element of this pipeline, you must first love who you are. And loving who you are is not calling yourself a nigger, and it ain't calling your sisters a bitch and a hoe. I'm gonna get through the rest of this. I wanna move towards the end. Just keep rolling. Feel me, folks. Feel me. This is why that word is purged from my system. Now let me tell you what happened in the state of in Seattle, Washington. There was a state senator by the name of Decio who insulted another white Republican. He insulted him, but the white guy, he bounced off of it. He threw another insult, he bounced off of it. And then to give him the ultimate insult, this state senator said, "You like a nigger in a wood pile." And when I went to deal with that, you know what they said to me? "Well, why are you getting upset, NAACP? Black children do it all the time. Why are you getting upset? Rappers do it all the time." And you know what I told them? "Rappers ain't never made laws that enslaved me. Rappers ain't never made laws that made me a second-class citizen. Rappers ain't never made laws that denied me the right to vote. Rappers ain't never made laws that gave me unequal access to any place else. Lawmakers did it, Decio did it, and Decio got to go. But there were some black folks in the state assembly who said, we accept his apology, not on my behalf. Not on behalf of the NAACP. My racial dignity is not your trying to get along, to be alone, so that the next time the election comes up, you hope that these white folks will vote you in because you done sold yourself down the river. I don't have nothing against nobody white. Hell, somebody was tipping in my family. I love humanity, but humanity got to learn to love me. And that love starts with who I am. So let me come with this. When I got arrested, people were worried about it. Carl, what were you thinking when you got arrested? See, I got a wife, I got a child. It's not that I'm trying to be a martyr, but history, culture, gave me the strength to go ahead. This is what I heard when I got arrested. "Now, I don't want to give you the impression that it's going to be easy. There can be no great social gain without individual pain. Before the victory for brotherhood is won, some will have to get scarred up a bit. Before the victory is won, some more will be thrown into jail. Before the victory is won, some, like Medgar Evers, may have to face physical death. But if physical death is the price that some must pay to free their children and their white brothers from an eternal psychological death, then nothing can be more redemptive. Before the victory is won, some will be misunderstood and called bad names. But we must go on with the determination and with the faith that this problem can be solved." And as I sat in that jail cell and I listened to Martin, I felt more and more empowered. And so now when I come out there and they blast me over the TV or they blast me over the radio talking about he's an agitator, when some of you look at me and say he's on the extreme, he's an agitator, well, Frederick Douglass tells me about agitation. And this is what Frederick says. He says that any man who professes the favor of freedom, but you detest agitation, When you a man who wants crops without plowing the field, you want the ocean without its awful roar, you want rain without thunder and lightning. You better believe this, that the NAACP and Nesbitt, we must be thunder and lightning.
National directors, and one of the directors this year was cultural enrichment. And the question came up, well, what's cultural enrichment? We talk about our history, we talk about contributions that blacks have made in technology and the sciences in particular, because our organization and our background. And then we just talk about history and where we've come from, where we're going, strengthening the pipeline of success. And I was reading on Share a few years back and had the pleasure, actually the honor, I listened to this man speak at our closing session banquet. I don't think you left that room for a good hour, hour and a half afterwards, just talking to individuals, signing autographs, taking pictures, and he stayed and accommodated us. And again, this is my second time being able to address you on stage in front of a welcoming audience. I want to thank you for this message. It's a gift. And SBE, Carl Mack, on behalf of our organization, I want to present this plaque to you as a very, very small token. Very, very small token of our appreciation. But I want to thank you for coming out and providing what we indeed term spiritual enrichment today. So thank you.
And let me say this. This is not, nobody could give me anything compared to what you all have given me, even before I stepped on the stage. And I know an attentive audience when I see one. And I feel you, I feel your love. I'm not trying to say something to give you a good speech. This is the way a brother lives. It's just the way I live. So it's not about giving you a speech. It's hoping that you can come back and go get our children, because they need us. I swear to God, they need us. We just filed a $40 million claim of damages against the Kent School District in Kent, Washington. You know why? Because they got adults there who think that the best way to deal with our children when they get out of line is to grab them by their hair, slam them up into lockers, throw them on the ground, put their weight on them and handcuff them. Fine. You're gonna see us. We got them on notice. I'm an engineer, people, but I'm a culturally responsible engineer, making a positive impact. And the only thing else I'll say to you is, I know some of you will ask me, well, Mr. Mack, do you have some of the calories? And one of my friends brought some up. I didn't come with any of them, but he has something outside. So if you're interested in them, fine. If not, don't sweat it. But that's about, swear to God, I love you so much. Thank you.
Kevin McAllister from the CPC.